Hello students, good morning. In yesterday's class, we completed all four members of endomembrane system. Now let's today continue with rest of the cell membranes. So today we are going to start, we are going to study structure of one of the important cell organelles, that are plastids. Okay, so today we will try to complete the structure and function of plastid. Okay, and after plastids, we are going to study structure of mitochondria also. Fine. So without wasting time, let's start the next cell organelle, that is plastids. Okay. We are going to study plastids. We have not started chloroplast. In your previous standards, you have learned that in case of plant cells, there are chloroplasts which are filled with photosynthetic units. Chloroplasts perform a major function of synthesis of food material by utilizing raw organic material in the presence of light energy. So that process, it is known as photosynthesis. So plastids, they are not only green in color. There are different types of plastids. From that, chloroplast, it is one of the category which are involved in photosynthesis, okay, in which plant prepare their food material. So these plastids, these are again cell organelles, just like your rest of the cell organelles. They also have an envelope of two membranes. Okay, so there is outer membrane and there is inner membrane. So we can call it as a double membranous structure. Chloroplasts or these plastids are autonomous. Now why they are called as autonomous, that we will learn later on. Fine. So these plastids, they are exclusively present in plant cells. In animal cells, these plastids are absent. While studying differences in plant cells and animal cells, already we have learned this. Fine. So plastids, they are of different types. And besides photosynthesis, they perform some other functions also. So let's see structure and function of plastids. Now these plastids, they were first discovered or were first identified by E. Haeckel in 1965. So we will see for general things related to plastids. We will discuss it different types and then we will move towards structure and function of chloroplast. Fine. So plastids term was introduced by introduced by E. Haeckel in 1866. So in 1866, term plastid was first time given or used by E. Haeckel. Now what are these plastids? These plastids, they are double enveloped cell organelles, okay, which are primarily involved in synthesis and storage of biomolecule or different organic compounds. Fine. So plastids are semi-autonomous. Just underline this word. Okay, semi-autonomous. Now why plastids are called as semi-autonomous, that we will study in detail. These are semi-autonomous DNA containing having double membranous envelope, okay, which are involved in storage and synthesis of different organic substances. Involved in storage and synthesis of various organic compounds, compounds. So I tried to define it in a very short way. These are semi-autonomous. Fine, now I'll explain why they are called as semi-autonomous. See, autonomous means what? Those who are able to regulate all their functions or all activities. As you know that in a cell there is a nucleus, fine? This nucleus acts as a headquarter, it acts as a brain of a cell, okay? Why? Because it consists of nucleic acid, it consists of genetic material. That is DNA, obviously. This DNA regulates all activities of cell. Okay? So we call it nucleus controls all activities of cell. Now, besides nucleus, in a eukaryotic cell, there are two more structures. Okay? They contain its own DNA. So from that first one, that is plastids, and the second one, that is mitochondria. See, just try to understand. Besides nuclear DNA, which is present inside the nucleus, there are two more cell organelles, that is mitochondria and plastid. They also contain circular DNA. In case of eukaryotic cell, the nuclear DNA is linear, but the DNA of plastid, it is circular, okay? It is not linear, fine. Now here, what is the condition? The DNA which is present in this plastid, it can synthesize some enzymes or proteins which are required for its own functioning, that is photosynthesis. Some enzymes which are required for the process of photosynthesis can be synthesized inside this plastid. Means this chloroplast, for some or for its some function, it depends upon the nuclear genes, but it can synthesize its own enzymes and proteins also. So they are known as semi-autonomous. They are not fully autonomous. Okay, they can synthesize some enzymes, some proteins which are essential for photosynthesis, okay, or different types of biochemical reactions, okay, with the help of DNA which is present in this. The DNA which is present in plastid, it is known as plastid DNA. Fine. The nuclear DNA, it is one which is present inside the nucleus. Because of this, it is known as semi-autonomous. Fine. Now, when we say it has a DNA copy, it is involved in the protein synthesis. So, all the machinery which is required for protein synthesis, that also has to be present inside the chloroplast. So along with DNA, there is RNA also, there are ribosomes also, fine. So we have seen while discussing the part of cell and cytoplasm, fine, that ribosomes are present either attached to endoplasmic reticulum or in cytoplasm, and these two cell organelles, that is plastid, or that you can say chloroplast and mitochondria, because these two cell organelles, they have circular DNA. Okay, genes undergo transcription, translation, they form different proteins, enzymes which are required for their own functioning, for the process of photosynthesis. So along with DNA, these plastids contain RNA also. They have different types of proteins also, which are essential for their own function. So we call them as semi-autonomous. Okay? These plastids, they have double membrane. There are two membranes. There is outer membrane as well as there is inner membrane. These two membranes, they are separated by intermembranal space. Its width, its details, that we will see later on when we study the structure of plastid. And their function, they perform two important functions. As I told you, in your previous standards, you have learned about chloroplast. Chloroplasts are one of the type or criteria in plastids. Along with chloroplasts, there are some other types of plastids also. And these plastids, they are involved in the storage of material. Okay, so along with synthesis of organic compounds, these plastids are also performing function of storage. So these plastids, they store as well as synthesize different types of organic materials. Whenever they synthesize, okay, they use the raw material, and with the help of sunlight, they prepare different types of organic compounds. Fine. So these plastids, they are involved in the storage and synthesis of different organic compounds. Fine. The next point we will discuss. These plastids, blastids, they develop from a precursor, or you can say its immature form. They are known as proplastids. So develop from colorless precursors, it is called as proplastids. Now precursor means any startup material, raw material. So these mature plastids, they form from colorless precursor. These mature, they develop into plastids, fine. So these colorless precursors, they are known as proplastids, fine. The next point we will discuss that, as I told you, these plastids, they are present only in plant cells as well as in eugenol. Plastids are totally absent in animal cell, okay. Their number also varies in different groups of plants. If you say in case of alga, the number may range from one to many. In case of plant cells also, but the number, it is fixed in a particular species. Yes, there is a variation in the shape of chloroplast also. We will study some examples along with the type of shape. Fine. So present in plant cells, okay, and eugenoids. Okay, these plastids are absent in animal cells. Absent in animal cells. Okay, now depending upon the color and type of pigment which is present in this, this pigment or this plastid, they could be of different types. So depending upon color, then its function, there are three types of plastids. Okay, so depending upon its color and what function they perform, there are three types of plastid. We will just take a primary idea over there. Afterwards, I'll rub the part and then I'll explain this again. So these plastids are of three types. Okay, depending upon its color and its function. Okay, so the first type, it is known as leucoplast. Okay, second type, it is known as chromoplast. Okay, and the third type of plastid, it is known as chloroplast. Okay, I have written here three types of plastids based on its color. The color it gets, it depends upon the number of pigments which are present in it. So depend upon color and depends on the function. These plastids, they could be classified in three types. First one, leucoplast. Second one, that is chromoplast. And third one, that is chloroplast. Fine. I'll give you the primary idea over here. Now, leucoplast. Leucoplast, leucos word meaning, you can say the colorless. These plastids are colorless. They don't have particular color. Now, if they are colorless, means they don't have any type of photosynthetic pigment. If they don't have photosynthetic pigments, means they are not performing function of photosynthesis. So these leucoplasts, they are not involved in photosynthesis. Then what they do? They help in the storage of different types of organic compounds. They can store starch, they can store proteins, they can store lipids. Based on this, or based on the type of stored food present, again there are three types of leucoplasts. We will see afterwards. So leucoplasts means these are the colorless plastids, and they perform function of storage of organic food. The second type, that is chromoplast. Fine. Chromoplast, chroma meaning what? Chroma meaning color. So these plastids, they are variously colored and they usually range between yellowish orange to red in color. Many a time you have seen the color change when there is a raw tomato which is green in color. When it is ripened, it turns into red in color. What happens exactly at that time? Why that green color tomato, it changes into red color tomato? So this is because chloroplasts, which are green colored, they transformed into red or orange colored chromoplast. Fine. So these chromoplasts, these are the plastids which are present in non-green cells. Just try to understand difference between chromoplast and chloroplast. Yes, chloroplast means these are your green plastids. Okay, plastids which are green in color, which are filled with photosynthetic pigments like chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, carotenoids, xanthophylls. These are your common photosynthetic pigments. So chloroplasts are filled with photosynthetic pigments, so they appear green in color. So all parts of plants which appear green in color, they consist of chloroplasts. Then what about rest of the colors? Some parts of plant, they are orange in color, some are red in color, yellow in color. So these coloration, because at the time of ripening, your chloroplasts get transformed into chloroplasts, which are the colored plastids. So at the time of ripening, when that green tomato, it transforms into red color tomato, that time chloroplasts get replaced or get transformed into chromoplasts. So your carrot, orange shade of the carrot, red color your chili, this is because of chromoplast. Fine. So colored plastids are known as chromoplast, green plastids are known as chloroplast. Fine. We are going to write all the things, some details related to this, but just try to understand three basic types of plastids. First one, it is known as leucoplast. These are the colorless plastids. They don't have any type of photosynthetic pigment in it. So they function or they perform the function of storage of food material. Chromoplast and chloroplast. Chromoplast, these are the colored plastid, usually range from yellow, orange to red in color. Whereas chloroplast, these are the green plastid present in all green parts of plant. Fine. I hope you have understood the basic things which can help to classify all these three types. Now we will see in detail. Okay. So now let's see the type of, I'll just take duster. Now we'll see all the three types in detail. Okay. And we will mention some notes for this. Now let's see types of plastics. I'm keeping this here. I'm making a big flow chart. You can also write in the same way. As I told you in my introductory lecture, write less, but it should be perfect. Okay. Try to mention each and everything. So some points, if you find that these are extra points, means by explaining, if you feel that this point is important, just note down that point in your notes. Okay. Notes should be precise but accurate. 100% contained should be there. Okay. So first type, leucoplast. Leucoplast, chromoplast, and chloroplast. Right? Now let's start discussing about leucoplast first. As I told you, these are colorless plastids. Leucoplast, colorless plastids. Where are they located? They are located in non-green parts of plant. You can say stem, then root, okay. So present in non-green plants. Present in non-green parts of plant. They are devoid of photosynthetic pigments. Devoid of photosynthetic pigments. Devoid of photosynthetic pigments, they are involved in storage of nutrients. And in these, grana are absent. Okay, right now you just mentioned this term or this statement. Later on you will understand its meaning. So in this, grana or grana is absent. Granum, it is a lamella structure, lamella part, which consists of photosynthetic pigments. As they don't have photosynthetic pigments, so they don't have grana also. Now, based on the type of nutrient they store, there are three types of leucoplasts. Now, let's see which are those types. It's very interesting. Let's see the first one. Okay, I have little space over here, so I'll just mention over here. If you have proper space in your notebook, you can just continue over here. So there are three types. Okay, there are three types of leucoplast. Okay, now these types are based on what? These types are based on the type of nutrient which is stored in it. Okay, let's see which are those types. First one is known as amyloplast. Second one, leioplast. And third one, alluroplast. These are the three types of plastid based on the type of nutrient they store. Amyloplast. Okay, let's see the first one, amyloplast. Amyloplast are those plastids we store starch, sugar molecules. Starch are stored in them. So they are known as amyloplast. Okay, they are much bigger in size. They store starch inside. Second one, that is leioplast. Okay, leioplast are those plastids we store fats or lipids, whereas alluroplast are those we store proteins. So protein rich seeds, protein rich grains, okay, they have abundant alluroplast in them. Okay, alluroplast. So three types, amyloplast, second that is leioplast, and third one that is alluroplast. We'll mention some things for it. Amyloplast store starch. Okay, they store starch. So present in potato tubers. Examples, if we will mention potato tubers, rice, wheat. So all those foods which are rich in starch, okay, they have abundant amyloplast. Obviously, we know that these are the colorless plastic. Second, that is leioplast, also known as lipidoplast, because they store lipids. Lipidoplast, okay, stores lipid or fats. Okay, now you can also tell me examples, those seeds, okay, oil yielding seeds. Okay, so sunflower, sesame, mustard, sesame, all your oil seeds, castor. Okay, those parts of plant where oils are stored, these oils are stored in lipidoplast or in leioplast. The third one, that is alluroplast. Alluroplast means they store proteins. Okay, so protein rich food material or food parts of plant, they are rich in alluroplast. For example, alluron layer of maize. Okay, as you know that maize, it is a rich source of proteins. So where are these proteins are stored? These proteins are stored in alluron layer. Fine. Now these are the types of leucoplast based on the type of nutrient they store. Fine. Now the next we will see, these leucoplasts, they are variable in size. Their size, it is not fixed, as I told you. So one point we will mention, they are variable in size. Their size, it is different. Okay, so these are three types of leucoplast. Okay, now let's see the next type of plastid, that is chromoplast, which are your colored plastid. Okay, they have carotenoids and xanthophylls. Both of them, they are responsible for yellow, orange to red coloration. So except green pigments, that is chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, these pigments are absent. So chromoplast, they consist of xanthophyll and carotenoids, which give yellowish brown orange, yellowish to red color to the parts. So let's write about this. Consist of fat soluble colored pigments like carotenoids and xanthophylls. They are also called as red or the yellow orange plastids. Also called as yellow orange red plastids. So except green, they have photosynthetic pigments. These are carotenoids and xanthophyll. The carrots, okay, your tomato, carrot, okay, they are rich in this. Okay, so some examples we will mention. First one, tomato. Okay, in case of tomato, the pigment which is present, it is known as lycopene. Okay, in case of tomato, there is a lycopene. In case of carrot, there is alpha and beta carotene. Okay, everyone might be knowing what is the significance of this beta carotene. This beta carotene, it is a precursor of vitamin A. Beta carotene, precursor of vitamin A. Okay, so if you are eating carrots regularly, you will not suffer from any disorder related to eye. Okay. So beta carotene is a precursor of vitamin A. Fine. So tomato has lycopene, carrot has alpha and beta carotene. Now this chromoplast are formed from whom? As I told you, at the time of ripening, what happened? This chloroplast, they transformed into chromoplast. So one point I will mention over here, formed from chloroplast. Okay, at the time of ripening, they can be formed. I'll mention can be formed. Okay, because in some fruits they might be present from beginning. In some fruits, from or when it is in raw condition, from that to the whole process of ripening, that time this chloroplast, they transformed into chromoplast. Fine. So this is the second type, formed from the chloroplast. Now these chromoplasts, they perform several functions. First one, as it gives very bright color to fruits as well as to flowers, it gives yellow, orange, red color. It makes plant parts attractive. As you know that flowers have bright color one to attract insect for the sake of pollination. In the same way, fruits also get very beautiful bright color so that they can attract animals or insect for the seed dispersal. Fine. So they are responsible to give specific colors to flowers and fruits. Okay. So this is the second type of plastid, that is known as chromoplast. Okay. They are also known as colored plastid. Now let's see the last type, that is chloroplast, which we are going to study as a cell organelle in detail. Okay, so here we will mention few things. So chloroplast, these are green plastids. Green plastids. Okay. Why they appear green in color? Because they are filled with chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, which gives them green color. Green plastids have photosynthetic pigments. They have photosynthetic pigments. They have photosynthetic pigments. And what is their function? They are primarily involved in synthesis of organic food material. Okay. Function is synthesis of organic compounds using raw material in the presence of light. Fine. So these are three types of plastids we have discussed in detail. Fine. From that leucoplast and chromoplast, this much information it is enough. Now we are going to study details of chloroplast regarding its ultrastructure, very important cell organelle for plants. Without chloroplast, plants are not able to synthesize the food material. Without plants, we are unable to survive on this earth. Okay, so the very important cell organelle, chloroplast. Now let's start the study of chloroplast. We will try to finish it by today itself, so that tomorrow we can start next cell organelle. Okay, fine. Now we are going to study its structure. But before that, like every time, first we'll see some general things related to size, shape, its distribution, and then we will move toward its structure. So give heading chloroplast. Chloroplast, fine, sure. First we'll see size, its shape. As I told you, there is a variation in the shape of chloroplast. So we are going to study some examples. If we consider the size, okay, the size of chloroplast, usually in case of plant cells, they're about 2 to 4 micrometer in thickness, 2 to 4 micrometer in thickness, and about 5 to 10 micrometer in length. Okay, now chloroplasts, they are very big in size. This is the largest cell organelle in plant cells. Okay, you can observe its shape. If you mount any leaf or the any green parts of a plant cell under your light microscope, then also you can observe it. Not the internal structure, but you can observe a chloroplast. So they are much larger in size and largest cell organelle in plant cells. Okay, it is larger in size and largest cell organelle in plant cell. Its shape varies. There is a great diversity in the shape of chloroplast. So that point is also very important with respect to MCQ. Okay, size, shape. Okay, in chloroplast, as I told you, there is a great variation. Great variation in shapes. Okay, we'll mention some examples. These examples you have to remember. Okay, it may be plate like, its shape, it could be plate like. It is in one of the algae that is known as Euloothrix. It may be cup shaped. Again in algae, its name it is Chlamydomonas. Chlamydomonas. In this, it is cup shaped. It may be ribbon-like or spiral or helical, anyone, ribbon-like, spiral or helical, that is in Spirogyra, it may be stillet or star-shaped, again in green algae, that is Zygnema. It could be reticulate, means like a network, reticulate shape, just like a network or mesh, again in one algae that is known as Udogonium. And in case of plant cell, it is lens shape, and say oval or lens shape. Okay, so sixth one we'll mention, it is lens shape in plant cells. In plants, okay, chloroplasts are largest cell organelle and they are lens shaped or they are oval in shape. So these examples you have to remember. If you are solving MCQs from reference book, definitely you will get such type of questions. So you have to remember these examples. So in case of plant cells, they are oval or they are lens shaped and are the largest cell organelle, very important cell organelle. Because of chloroplast, the energy from sun is entering in this universe. Plants, we know that plants are able to prepare their food material, they are the sources of energy. From their energy, it is transferred toward the next trophic level. We are getting food, we are getting energy from plants. Okay, animals are getting energy from plants. So for this, chloroplasts are very important because they are synthesizing this organic food. So this is about shape. The number also varies. So if we see the number, okay, number of chloroplasts, it also varies from 1 to many. I'll write over here. Number varies from species to species, but it is usually maintained, it is usually fixed for a cell. Okay, we can mention some examples. For example, in case of Chlamydomonas, As well as Euloothrix, they have only one chloroplast. Fine. So as I told you, number varies from organism to organism, but usually it is fixed for the cell. Fine. So Chlamydomonas and Euloothrix, they have only one chloroplast. If we consider the general plant cell, they have usually 20 to 40 chloroplasts per cell. So in case of plant cells, generally 20 to 40 chloroplasts are present, whereas there are hundreds of chloroplasts per cell in the rhizoidal cell of Cara, which is again a green algae. In the internodal cell of Cara. Okay. It has several hundreds. Okay, several hundred. Okay, so many chloroplasts could be present, but number remains same for cells of one organism. Okay, so these are some general things, okay, related to chloroplasts. Now we will move toward the ultrastructure of chloroplasts, and that is very important. Number of questions can be asked on this. Now for this, what we are going to do, we are going to draw one big diagram. Okay, you will also draw in the same way. So now onward, wherever we will go for the ultrastructure, you have to use the whole page of your notebook. In that we will draw the diagram in detail, and wherever we are giving the labels, just below that we are going to write all the things. This is just to minimize the writing. But the thing is that you have to understand each and everything. For this you can use color pens, okay, to show different regions. Fine. But we are going to mention all the details, but it will not be in the form of sentence. So that much ability now you have to build. Otherwise, as you know, this is a theoretical subject. I can give you more than 10 pages information only for the structure, but that much it is not required. Slowly, slowly you have to develop this habit in you. Just go on mentioning all your notes with the help of diagrams. Once you will start writing your notes in this way, biology, it is the easiest subject. You will be able to remember each and everything. So today we will try to do like this. After this you will can you can also do by your own. So let's start with the structure of chloroplast. Fine. As I told you, chloroplasts, they are oval shaped, they are lens shaped in case of plant cells. Okay, so we will draw its membrane. Chloroplasts have two membranes, outer membrane and inner membrane. These are biomembranes like our normal. Okay, so their structure, it is also same like our cell membrane. Okay, so these are the double membranous lens shaped oval shaped structures. Okay, larger in size, they are much larger. That's sometimes we are unable to see nucleus also. Nucleus gets hide inside this chloroplast because their number, it is also more. So these are two membranes. We can label it as outer membrane, outer membrane. This is inner membrane, outer membrane and inner membrane. The outer membrane, it is more permeable than inner membrane. Now we will go on mentioning our points in this. Outer membrane more permeable, it is more permeable, whereas inner membrane is less permeable. More permeable and less permeable. Both these membranes, they are nearly 90 to 100 angstrom unit in thickness. So 90 to 100 angstrom unit in thickness. Okay, for both. So 90 to 100 angstrom unit thick. Now, as there are two membranes, these two membranes are separated by a space. That space, it is known as intermembranal space. So this space, okay, the gap between these two membranes, it is known as intermembranal space. Fine, we will label that also. And its width is about 100 to 200 angstrom units. Intermembranal space, intermembranal. Okay, it is also known as periplacidal space, intermembranal or periplacidal space. This space has width of about 100 to 200 angstrom unit. Okay, about 100 to 200 angstrom unit. Okay, first point, I hope you have understood. Every chloroplast has two membranes, outer membrane which is more permeable, okay, whereas inner membrane it is less permeable. These two membranes encloses a cavity that is known as intermembranal or periplastidial space. Fine, no doubt up to this now. This membranes includes a semi-solid, okay, colloidal jelly-like material that is known as stroma or matrix. Fine. So all the semi-solid, okay, colloidal complex material which is present or which is enclosed within this nest, okay, it is known as stroma. Okay. So stroma or matrix. So these two membranes or envelope, plastid envelope, encloses semi-solid colloidal material that is known as stroma or matrix. Okay, I'll label this part over here, that is stroma or matrix. Just try to understand the structure in detail because your whole photosynthesis, okay, process of photosynthesis, it depends on the structure of chloroplast. Okay, in upcoming lessons we are going to study photosynthesis also, so for that structure of chloroplast should be clear. Now stroma or matrix, now what is this? This is semi-fluid colloidal substance. It encloses all those things which confine to chloroplast. Now let's see what is there in this stroma. Now stroma consists of different enzymes required for photosynthesis. Stroma consists of some parallelly run lamellar structures which are filled with photosynthetic units. These are known as thylakoids. Along with these, there is a circular DNA. They may be present in multiple copies also. There is RNA also. As I told you, all the things which are required for protein synthesis, there are ribosomes also, as well as there are starch granules also. In some chloroplasts or in mature chloroplasts, starch grains can be stored. Fine. So all these things are present in stroma. So enzymes, okay, usually enzymes for dark reaction, I will explain this point, enzymes of dark reaction, very important, fine, enzymes of dark reaction, then DNA, okay, thylakoids, RNA, ribosomes, starch granules, okay, all these things are present in this stroma. The important point here, that is the enzymes of dark reaction. Now what is dark reaction? If you have learned the process of photosynthesis in your previous standards, you might have learned that photosynthesis takes place at two phases. That is known as light reaction and dark reaction. Light reaction, it is also known as light dependent reaction, where all the reactions are performed with the help of photosynthetic pigments. The second phase of photosynthesis involves reduction of carbon dioxide into sugar molecules. So for that, light it is not required. So it is known as light independent phase. It is also called as dark reaction. So in the process of formation of sugar molecules, it is again a very big pathway that you will learn in detail. Okay. So those reactions are known as dark reactions. Now all those enzymes, there is a large number of enzymes which are involved in the reduction of carbon dioxide into sugar. All those enzymes are present in stroma. So stroma, it is a site of dark reaction where carbon dioxide is reduced in the form of sugar. It is a light independent reaction. Light it is not required, fine. So enzymes for dark reactions, they are present in the stroma or matrix, fine. Now what we will do now, we will draw these structures first and then we will study them in detail. So as I told you, there are parallelly run stroma, okay, or there are the parallelly run stroma lamellae, we call them as thylakoids, okay. So some of them they aggregate to form a stack like structure. Okay, we call them as a granula. Okay, so such stacks are present. Granula are present in the chloroplast. A part of it may form a stack, although they run parallelly, but they interconnect each other. They interconnect different granula. Okay, so here I am drawing structure of granula and thylakoid. Just try to understand. Fine. So I have shown few granula over here. Now see, these are the parallelly run thylakoid. Okay, these thylakoid, they just stack upon each other to form a stack like structure that is known as granula. So first label the structure. This single one, it is known as thylakoid. Okay, there are two types of thylakoids. I will explain that. Thylakoid, these are the parallelly run lamellar structures which are filled with photosynthetic units. These thylakoid, they stack upon each other to form a granula. Okay, singularly it is known as granula. Many are called as granula. Fine. So thylakoid, we will mention some things for it. So thylakoid, okay, run parallel lamellar structure. Okay, they contain photosynthetic units, contains photosynthetic units. These photosynthetic units are known as quantasomes. Okay, again very important point, known as quantasomes. Okay, photosynthetic units are known as quantasomes. Each thylakoid consists of about 250 to 400 quantasomes, and they are present or they are embedded in the membrane of thylakoid. These quantasomes were first discovered by Park and Beggins. This also you have to remember. Quantasomes discovered by Park and Beggins. Okay, they are discovered by Park and Beggins, and there are about 250 to 400 quantasomes per thylakoid. Okay, this number also you have to remember. Thylakoid, these are the parallelly run lamellar structure, okay, which are filled with photosynthetic units. These photosynthetic units, small, simple, sac-like structures, these are known as quantasomes. These quantasomes are filled with photosynthetic pigments like a chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, carotenoids, okay. So they are present in this quantasome. These quantasomes are called as photosynthetic units. They were discovered by Park and Beggins, and each chloroplast may consist, or your each quantasome, each thylakoid consists of 250 to 400 quantasomes. Okay, now these thylakoid at some places they just form stacks, and these stacks are known as granula. Singularly we call it as granula. Fine. So granula, it is a stack of thylakoid. Stacks of thylakoid. Okay, each granula may consist of 200 thylakoid. It may contain 200 thylakoid. 200 thylakoid. Okay, and there are 40 to 80 granula per cell. Okay, 40 to 80 granula perchloroplast. Okay, I know little bit analytical things are there, but you have to remember this thing. I'll explain this again. These are the parallelly run lamellar structures filled with photosynthetic pigments or unit. They are called as thylakoid. Thylakoids have membrane bound or membrane attached photosynthetic units. These are known as quantasomes, and these quantasomes are filled with photosynthetic pigments. Okay, then when these thylakoid, they just form stacks by just placing one of each or one above each other, they form granum. Singularly we call it as granum. Each granum may consist of 2 to 100 thylakoids, and each chloroplast may consist of 40 to 80 granum. Okay, so now these granum, it is a site of light reaction. So I will mention one point over here. It is a site of light reaction. There are two phases in photosynthesis, light reaction and dark reaction. Dark reaction takes place in stroma. It is an enzyme mediated process. Different enzymes are required for that. So all those enzymes of dark reaction, they are present in the stroma or matrix. Whereas light reaction, it depends upon or it is performed in the presence of photosynthetic pigments. Fine. These photosynthetic pigments are present in granum or thylakoid. So these granum, it is a site of light reaction. Right now, this much information, it is enough for you. Whenever we will study the lesson of photosynthesis, at that time, we will go in much detail. So that is the next part, that is granum and thylakoid. Along with this, what is present? Along with this, there is a circular DNA. As we discussed, because of presence of DNA, we call it as a semi-autonomous. It is not fully autonomous because it also depends upon the nuclear genes. It cannot survive by its own. It is dependent on its nuclear gene also. Okay, so this is circular DNA. Okay, this is the circular DNA. Along with this, there are ribosomes. So that also we will mention. Ribosomes. Okay. These ribosomes are of 70S type. Very important point. 70S type. MCQ favorite question. Eukaryotic ribosomes, they are 80S type. Prokaryotic ribosomes are 70S type. But there are two cell organelles, that is mitochondria and chloroplast. Their DNA, it is of 70S type. This keep in mind because questions will come on this part. Only two structures in eukaryotic cell, that is plastid DNA and mitochondrial DNA, they are of 70S type. Remaining all nuclear DNA, okay, or nuclear ribosomes which are present in cell, these ribosomes, they are of 80S type. Okay, so ribosomes are of 70S type. Okay, along with this, as we discussed, there may be starch grains. Okay, stored starch granules. So starch grains also we will get. And along with this, there could be RNA. Fine. So RNA is also required for protein synthesis. Okay. Now, when we studied the thylakoids, as I told you, there are two types of thylakoids. Some thylakoids, they participate in the form of granum, whereas some thylakoids, they are only in the matrix. So these are known as granular thylakoids, and the thylakoid which is present in between two granula, that is known as stromal thylakoid. I don't think it is need to mention over here, but fine, we will mention. So whenever you will revise your notes, you can understand it well. So this thylakoid, it is known as granular thylakoid. Granular thylakoid. Okay, whereas this is known as stromal thylakoid. stromal thylakoid or stroma lamellae, thylakoid or lamellae is also known as freight channel. Okay, also known as freight channel. Fine. So this is the structure of chloroplast. Fine. Quickly we will revise the structure and then we will end this session. Okay. So as you can see here, chloroplast, it is lens shape or oval shape in case of plant cell. It has an envelope which consists of two membranes, outer membrane which is more permeable to materials, inner membrane less permeable. It is separated by a space that is known as intermembranal or periplastidial space. The width of this space, it is about 100 to 200 angstrom unit. The membrane encloses a semi-fluid colloidal substance or fluid that is known as stroma or matrix. All the things or those things which are present in it consist of enzymes for dark reaction. There is a circular DNA, there is RNA, there are ribosomes, as well as there are thylakoids. Thylakoids, these are the parallelly run lamellar structure. They are filled with photosynthetic pigments. These thylakoids can be classified as stromal thylakoids or there could be granular thylakoids. A part of thylakoid is stacked upon each other and they form granulum. Okay? Granulum, it is a site of light reaction of photosynthesis. Fine. Along with this, there is circular DNA. Okay? DNA, it is circular. Okay? It is responsible to form some proteins or enzymes required for the process of photosynthesis. So we call it as semi-autonomous cell organ. Along with DNA, there is a ribosomes also, which are of 70S type. Then there are DNA, there is a RNA as well as starch grains also. So this is the structure of chloroplast. And if we consider the functions of chloroplast, already we have discussed those plastids which are colorless plastid, they help in the storage of nutrients. This chloroplast, they perform the function of photosynthesis. Energy, light energy, it is converted into chemical energy due to photosynthesis. So photosynthesis, it is possible only because of this chloroplast. Okay, as I told you, you have to make a big diagram on one page and mention all the things in that diagram. So again, no need to write any note for this. I hope you have understood the structure of chloroplast. Okay, if you have any doubt, just message me. Along with this, you have to read NCERT also. Read each and everything from NCERT. Study the diagram which is given in NCERT. Fine. In tomorrow's class, we will study the structure and function of mitochondria. Okay. Goodbye and have a nice day.